Good morning, St. John's. Y'all look incredible today. Whether you're joining us here in person this morning or whether you're joining us by our online video, we are delighted to have you with us today. Welcome. A few words of a few announcements to share with you this morning. First of all, please take note that on next Sunday, September 13th, is Epworth Sunday. We were unable to have our Mother's Day offering for Epworth due to COVID-19, but we are combining the fall and the Mother's Day offering next Sunday. So please give prayerful consideration to how you might support Epworth. Also would like to encourage you to consider coming to our 6 o'clock Sunday evening Vespers service. This service is growing in popularity. It's held outside around the fountain. Very informal, laid back, special time of prayer and hearing God's word. We invite you to come and join us. Also, I would like to make you aware that on September the 26th, here in Aiken, we will be a part of a national effort that's called The Return, a time of prayer for us to return to God in these troubling times in our world and in our nation. The service will be held, or the event will be held, from 10 to 1 at the Smith Hazel Recreation Center at 400 Kershaw Street. At 10:15, Dr. Tim will be leading prayer, and we invite you all to come and be a part of that. At this time, I would like to invite you to stand as you're able for our opening hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Thank you.
Let us remain standing as we affirm that which we believe with the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Be seated.
Pray together. Gracious God, you have been merciful and kind to us. Your grace has been shown in our lives through what Jesus, your Son, your only begotten Son, has done. We come this day asking for forgiveness. We come this day seeking Jesus as the Prince of Peace to enter our world once again and bring peace to hearts that have been inflamed by injustice and oppression, worry and anxiety. Lord, we pray that you might bless our country, that we might indeed be a city set on a hill, a lamp not hidden, but one that shines its light throughout the world. Lord, we pray for our country that there might be peace, no rioting. We pray that indeed you might protect us and protect those we love. We pray, O God, that you might bless the scientists and the doctors and all the medical personnel as they seek to find ways to bring healing. We do pray, God, that you might provide a vaccine so that we can defeat the coronavirus. Lord, we pray for all the persons as we celebrate this Labor Day Sunday, all the persons who have given of themselves in worthwhile work. Lord, you've given each of us different abilities and gifts and given us different tasks. We pray, God, that you might help us to live up to the calling that we have received from you as each of us has been given work to do. We pray for our teachers and students as they have embarked on a new year in whatever permutation that has taken place. We pray that you might bless all the administrators, janitors, the teachers, the aides, the students and their parents, and all those who love education. Lord, we pray that you might bring some semblance of normalcy back into our lives. But Lord, remind us that peace will not come to our land. Education will not take place. This world will not be blessed unless we put you first. So help us to be people of prayer. Help us to be people who will seek peace and not harm. Help us to be people who will put on Christ so that when people look at us, they might see the Lord Jesus. Forgive us, O Lord, we pray. Have mercy upon us. Please bless our land as we return to you. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, the one who taught his disciples praying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Romans, chapter 13, beginning at verse 8. The book of Romans, in many ways, is a theological discourse. It's a treatise. But the last few chapters, chapters 12, 13, 14, 15, and even the long greetings in chapter 16, are very practical ways in which we can learn how to live as Christians in a very difficult time. So hear these words from Romans chapter 13, beginning at verse 8. Let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. For whoever loves others has fulfilled the law. The commandments, thou shalt not commit adultery, thou shalt not murder, thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not covet, and whatever other command there may be, are summed up in this one command: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no harm to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfillment of the law. And do this, understanding the present time, the hour has already come for you to wake up from your slumber, because our salvation is nearer now than when we first believed. The night is nearly over. The day is almost here. So let us put aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave decently as in the daytime, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual immorality and debauchery, not in dissension and jealousy. Rather, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ and do not think about how to gratify the desires of the flesh. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. As I think about this being Labor Day Sunday and tomorrow being Labor Day, as I think about our work and trying to answer the question when people ask it, who do you work for? I'm reminded that as a Methodist minister, it's sort of a difficult question to answer. Because for Social Security purposes, all United Methodist clergy, for Social Security purposes, are self-employed. But for income tax purposes, all United Methodist ministers are employees. It seems that the federal government hasn't quite figured out what we are. Are we self-employed or are we employees? It's an interesting situation. Some of that came to mind, especially when I was ordained and was given my orders. The bishop asked the same questions every year of those who are being ordained. These same questions have been asked ever since John Wesley, our founder, started asking them centuries ago. One of those questions, one of the many questions, is, are you in debt so much as to embarrass yourself in the work? Are you in debt so much as to embarrass yourself in the work, meaning the work of ministry? Now, one of my tasks as the elected parliamentarian for the annual conference is to sit beside the bishop to interpret rules of law, canon law, church law, and also to make sure that when people are answering these questions, such as this one, are you in debt so far as to embarrass yourself in your work, to make sure that people are answering correctly. I'll never forget the year when the bishop asked that question, and already standing there, the candidates, the ordinands, had little smiles on their faces because they knew they were pretty much in debt. School debt, educational debt, other kinds of debt. And so they had little smiles, and so the bishop asked the question, are you in debt so far as to embarrass yourself in your work? And then seeing their little grins, he says, now, some of you don't embarrass easily. So are you in debt so far as to embarrass, and he pointed at himself, me? Indeed, it's a question that Paul tries to answer. Here in Romans chapter 13, he says, let no debt remain outstanding except the continuing debt to love one another. The continuing debt to love one another. Now, before we start thinking that love is some kind of mushy, gooey, fluffy, warm feeling, now it may be all those things, but real love is not like the movie Love Story from years ago with Ryan O'Neal and Ally McGraw. You know, the famous line from that movie is that love means you never have to say you're sorry. Well, any of you who've been married for some time or know anything about parenting or being a child, you know that love means saying you're sorry a lot. No, the kind of love that Paul talks about is it's not a wishy-washy kind of love. It's a very strong, powerful, deep, committed type of love. As a matter of fact, he defines love, this debt that should remain, he defines love by using the thou shalt nots of the Ten Commandments. The thou shalt nots of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt not commit adultery. He defines love that way. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not steal. Thou shalt not covet. Thou shalt not bear false witness. He uses these thou shalt nots. We live in a world and in a society, even in this country, where we just embrace love in such an easy sort of way that we forget that it has boundaries. Thou shalt nots. Our society, in my opinion, needs more boundaries. We need more law giving and law keeping. We don't need more riots and we don't need more unrest. We need, as Paul puts it, common decency, which is so uncommon nowadays. Decency. He says, behave decently. Well, as I think about John Wesley once again, and I think about how he suggested that we as Methodists should live in the world, he gave three rules by which we should live and how we should live out love and what love really means. Strong love. He says that we are to do no harm, to do good, and to stay in love with God. Bishop Reuben Jobe wrote a little book called Three Simple Rules about these general rules for Methodist societies, Methodist groups. They're not simple. Do no harm, first of all. That's exactly what Paul says in verse 10. He says it literally, love does no harm. How much better would our world be if we all asked, is what I'm doing harm? Is it causing harm? A good example of doing no harm is a story from Elmer Bendiner's book, The Fall of Fortresses, which is about B-17s, as they flew over Nazi Germany dropping bombs during World War II. One of those B-17s was named the Tantalaya, the Tantalaya. It was flying over the German city named Kassel, K-A-S-S-E-L, dropping bombs. And as they were flying over the city, the pilot, whose name was Bon Fawkes, Captain Bon Fawkes, F-A-W-K-E-S, the German anti-aircraft fire was so heavy that it was piercing the fuselage. Bullets, these 20 millimeter bullets were piercing the fuselage and even hitting the gas tanks. And usually when bullets of that sort hit the gas tanks, the plane, as the gunpowder and the bullets met the gasoline, the flammable gasoline in the tanks, the plane would blow up, and we lost hundreds of planes and thousands of pilots and air personnel during World War II because of those bullets. But as Captain Fawkes was flying over the city of Kassel, as the bullets were zipping through and he could hear them hitting the gas tanks, they didn't explode. And so he safely landed the plane after their mission. And he wanted to get one of those bullets. He wanted to carry that bullet around with him in his pocket. You know, it was a miracle. He wanted that as a lucky charm, something for good luck. And so he got out of the plane. He went back, talked to the crew chief, and he said, I'd like one of those bullets that I heard hit the fuel tanks. And the crew chief said, I'm sorry, Captain Fawkes, I'm not able to do that. Matter of fact, there were 20 of those bullets. There were actually 20 bullets, 20 millimeter caliber, 20 millimeter bullets that hit the fuel tanks. But the intelligence guys, they've already come, Captain Fawkes, and they've collected them all. So Captain Fawkes went to where the intelligence guys' offices were and said, yeah, I'd like one of those bullets, but give me some sort of explanation. Why were you guys involved? And the intelligence guy said, none of those bullets had gunpowder in them. They were all empty except for one. And in that one was a tightly rolled up little piece of paper written in Czech. It was written in Czech, and we found someone on the base who could translate Czech, and it simply said, this is all we can do for you now. Now, what a way to do no harm. What a way to do no harm but to take the gunpowder out of the bullets so it wouldn't bring down Allied bombers. This is all we can do for you now. Well, perhaps that's all we can do now is to remove our explosive charges when we get around certain people. To not reply or respond to people who put things on Facebook that just rile us up. Wouldn't it be great if we would just take a back seat and have non-anxious presence, and rather than getting worked up in a tizzy ourselves and exploding and bringing the plane and the country and everything else down, what if we got rid of our road rage and our rioting and we did no harm? Wouldn't our world, wouldn't our country be a better place? And not only do no harm, to follow John Wesley's matrix, we should do good. It shows up in this passage of Scripture in verse 12. The night is nearly over. Put aside the deeds of darkness. Do good. A simple sounding thing, but to do good sometimes takes great sacrifice. To do no harm is one thing. To do good is quite another. It's an active thing to do. To do good. It reminds me of the old hymn that was in the Cokesbury hymnal. It's appropriate for Paul's words, but also for Labor Day. Work, for the night is coming. Some of you might remember that song. Work, for the night is coming. I'm not going to sing it for you. When man's work is done. Work, for the night is coming. When man works no more. Work, for the night is darkening. When man's work is o'er. There's going to be a judgment day, and there's going to be an end of the world, and we need to be prepared for it. The night is nearly over. The day is already upon us. We should do the best that we can while we can to put aside those deeds of darkness, put on the armor of light, and as he says it, let us behave decently. Let us behave decently. Common decency is pretty uncommon, isn't it? Common decency. Behaving, doing good. Let me tell you a couple of stories. You may have heard them before, but you know, if you've been married or been in a relationship, you will hear stories over and over again. If you've got good buddies, or if you've ever been fishing, stories even get better the more you hear them sometimes. It's a part of life. But there are two stories. Story number one is about a guy named Easy Eddie. He lived in Chicago during the days of Al Capone, Scarface, the mob boss in Chicago. Al Capone had never been arrested. He was behind a lot of racketeering, prostitution, bootlegging, murder, whatever he could get away with. And one of the ways that he could get away with things is because he had a lawyer, an accountant, named Easy Eddie. And he rewarded Easy Eddie for keeping him out of trouble. As a matter of fact, he set him up in a big mansion that took up a whole Chicago city block. Gave him all the money he ever needed or wanted to provide for his family, to take care of everything they ever needed. Even had security at his mansion, plus hired help to help take care of the family's needs. Easy Eddie had it made, except he had a soft spot for his son, and there were two things he could not give his son. He could not give him a good example, and he could not give him a good name. And one day, Easy Eddie decided he would start doing good, behaving decently, putting aside the deeds of darkness, as Paul puts it. And so you might remember Al Capone was not arrested for murder, prostitution, bootlegging, anything else. Al Capone went to prison for tax evasion. And how was he sent to prison? Where did they get their evidence? Easy Eddie. He decided to do good and give his son a good name and a good example. And he paid for it, because within a few months, even though Al Capone was in prison, Al Capone's minions gunned down. Murder was never solved. he was gunned down and killed on the streets of Chicago. That's story number one. Here's story number two. Story number two is about a guy named Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare. Butch O'Hare flew an F-4F Wildcat off of the deck of the USS Lexington, a United States aircraft carrier during World War II. One day, he took off with the rest of the squadron, and they were headed to go do a mission over a Japanese base. And so they got up in the air. They were some miles from the Lexington, not yet to their target. And he recognized, as he thumped the fuel gauge, that someone had forgotten to top off his fuel tank. And not only had they not topped off his fuel tank, but they had not replenished his ammunition. He radioed the squadron commander. Squadron commander said, "You need to get back to the Lexington." And so he's headed back to the Lexington, and as he's on his way back to the Lexington, there were 10 Japanese bombers in a V formation headed to bomb the Lexington, send it to the bottom, and all the other ships in the carrier group. And the only thing standing or flying between those bombers and the Lexington and the other ships was Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare. He used the little bit of ammunition that he had, and he shot down one bomber. Then he used his plane to clip off the rudder off another bomber and sent it spiraling down. And then he used his plane as a battering ram and he clipped the wing of another bomber on the right side and sent it spiraling down. Then he clipped the wing in his injured plane on the left side and sent it spiraling down. And then lastly, he used his whole plane, his F-4F Wildcat, and hit the tail section of another bomber and sent it down, almost crippling and crashing in his own plane in the process. The rest of the five bombers, the Japanese bombers, thought, "Let's get out of here. This crazy American's going to try to kill us all." And so they headed back to their base. And Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare was barely able to land his crippled plane. But everybody on the flight deck and everybody on the bridge had seen his heroism. They'd seen his amazing deeds. And because of those deeds, he was named the first United States Naval Aviator ace by taking down five planes of World War II. And he was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor, the Congressional Medal of Honor. Within a year, he was shot down in a nighttime raid. His plane, and he was lost. But the people of his hometown of Chicago didn't want to forget what he had done, and so they decided to name their airport after him. And I'll bet a lot of you have flown through O'Hare Airport. It's named for Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare. And if you've ever been at O'Hare and you've walked around any at all, if you've been between Terminal Number 1 and Terminal Number 2, then you've passed that display that has that F-4F Wildcat mounted there. And it has Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare's Medal of Honor encased. It's a powerful sight. Easy Eddie, that's story number one, he did what was good. Butch O'Hare, story number two, he did what was good. But do you know what the connection is between story number one and story number two? Butch O'Hare was Easy Eddie's son. True story. Look it up. It makes me wonder if Easy Eddie O'Hare had not chosen to do what is good, to put aside the deeds of darkness and to turn in Al Capone, if he had not decided to do what was good, would his son, Lieutenant Commander Butch O'Hare, would he have done what he did? Our actions have a ripple effect, don't they? And then lastly, not only are we to do no harm and we're to do all the good we can to do good, we're also to stay in love with God. And Paul writes about how we're to stay in love with God, and we know how to stay in love with God. It's sometimes a question of whether we do it or not, you know, through prayer, through reading the Bible, through being around other Christians, coming to worship, being a part of a church, however we can during this COVID pandemic. We're to do missions and do all the good we can. But the way Paul puts it is especially important. He says, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ. That if you want to stay close to God, if you want to stay in love with God, clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ so that when people see you, they see Jesus. There's a story about a young man. He had been married just a couple of years. He and his wife had a baby girl. She was a year and a half old. And he was leaving work, making his way back to his wife and daughter. A drunk driver ran a red light and hit him. They rushed him to the hospital. The family gathered there, his mom and dad, his wife, his daughter. The doctor came out from the operating room and said, I don't think we can save him. He's brain dead. What would you like to do? And they knew what that question meant. What would you like to do? So they huddled together, and quickly they decided that what their son, what their husband, what their father would have wanted is to help as many people as they could. And so they told the doctor to harvest all the organs that they could so that other people might have life. And they did that, and he died. There was another guy who had a bad heart. His heart was failing. He had lived a rough life. He didn't think that he deserved a heart transplant. He had not taken very good care of the one that he had. But he hoped. And sure enough, he received that young man's heart. Well, he wanted to contact the family and say, thank you. It changed his life to receive that grace like it changes our lives when Jesus changes us and loves us and we are forgiven. He wanted to say, thank you. But, you know, there are rules about receiving transplants. You can't just call people up. They won't even let you know who they are. Every state has different rules about this. And where he was living, they had a 5-year rule that you could not contact people to say thank you until 5 years had passed. And so 5 years passed, and sure enough, he contacted the family of the young man. They arranged to meet. The family of the young man drove to the man's house who had received the heart transplant. And out of the car, a young woman got out, and the man who had heard part of the story by then thought that must be his wife. And then out of the car was, it looked like a 7 or 8 year old, first or second grade. He thought that must be his daughter. And then an older woman got out. He thought to himself, that must be his mother. And then the guy behind the steering wheel got out, an older man. He thought that must be his dad. And his father was carrying over his shoulders a stethoscope. And so the dad walked over and said to the guy who had received his son's heart, he said, when my boy was little, he would get upset at night. He would get afraid, and he would come running into our room, and he would grab my neck and hold so tight I could hear his heart beating. And when he was a little bit older and things were rough at school for whatever reason, he would cry so hard with those heaving sobs that I could hear his heart beating. And when he married this young woman, he told me as we were about to walk in to stand at the front of the church, as he hugged my neck, "Daddy, I've never felt so much love in my life." And I could hear his heart beating. And when his baby girl was born, he said, "There's nothing like it." And he hugged my neck, and once again, I heard his heart beating. What I want to know, son, as he looked at the man who received his son's heart, is whether or not I can listen to my boy's heartbeat one more time. You know, I think God the Father wants to put a stethoscope to every one of our hearts and see if he can hear Jesus, his son's heartbeat, one more time. And I believe he can do that if we will follow these three rules that Paul so wonderfully talks about. Do no harm. Do good. Clothe yourselves with the Lord Jesus Christ so much that God the Father can hear his son's heartbeat. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the ways that you've shown us how to live. We just pray that our world might actually do it. We pray for peace in our country. We pray for our leaders. We pray for this upcoming election that we make wise choices, that we do no harm, that we do good, and that we uphold our love for you, and we stay in love with you. Oh, Lord, let our hearts beat true. Let our hearts beat true for you. This is our prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Before we receive our benediction and sing our doxology, I want to give just a couple of instructions that we will exit the church starting with the back first, the back rows, going out those side doors. And they're offering baskets there for you to use as God has given to you. We ask if you might give to God. We'd like for you to stay at least 6 feet apart unless you're with a family grouping and you live under the same roof. And make your ways to your vehicles. And God bless you for coming today and hope that you come again. And we're here to serve you. So let us stand now and let us receive this benediction. Now may the peace of God that passes all understanding guard your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus our Lord, both now and forevermore. Amen. Now may we sing. Peace.